Dear viewers, my name is Veronica Rose. You're most welcome to today's session. And I have a special guest for you. He's called Nikos and he's from Greece. He will go ahead and share with us his entire profile. Nikos?
Thank you, Veronica. It's an honor to be with you. And thanks for the invitation. A couple of things about me. I am an IT security audit professional working in the last years in the financial sector. I am in the National Bank of Greece, and I am skilled in cybersecurity, digital transformation, enterprise risk management, and all the things that actually ISACA brings us in our knowledge. So I am an ISACA Platinum level professional, CISA, CISM, CISA accredited trainer. I am the guy who is doing the preparation courses for Greece, and ISO 27001 lead auditor, and I am honored to be participating in the IT audit leaders group in ISACA International every year at Eurocax. So this is my profile. I don't want to give you any more details, but I would like to know what we will discuss about today. So do you have a question for me?
Yes, I do. And our topic of discussion today will be on digital transformation. So you and I understand the key concept of digital transformation, that it's not about just technology, that it's about strategy and change of the old mindset. So Nikos would like you to share with us what is the impact of digital transformation on our lives today, like in the industry we work in today.
So what you said, in spite of what everybody thinks, digital transformation, even if it's digital, it's not about technology. It's about strategy. And a corporation strategy is based on a business, as you said, mindset. Somebody has a vision, and IT has to realize this vision, implement some things that they will. I always wanted to go to the moon. Nobody gave me a space shuttle, a rocket. But if I have a strong IT division, they'll build me one, and then I will go to the moon because this is the objective. So it's about having a mindset, having visions, and how technology allows us to make them reality. So apart from the mindset, it's about people that have the ideas and implement it. It's about the process and the model that we follow to make it real. And it's about the tools, which is probably the closest thing to technology, but this is the last part of it. If you don't have the first three things, tools is something that will not give you the objective. A space shuttle will not make you an astronaut. So areas that we'll go through, and I will stay on a very specific word that somehow we miss the value, expectation. What do we expect from digital transformation? Because if we don't expect something out of it, we will not invest on it. In some areas in our life, generally in industries, you expect digital transformation to be in the driver's seat. For example, you expect IT to have a constant transformation and involvement, because this is IT. If you check the last 5 years where IT was and where IT is and where IT will be in the next 5 years, it's something completely different. So it's inherent, the transformation you expect to happen. And there are wonderful things right now like Kubernetes and edge computing that 3 years ago were in the beginning. Back then we had virtual machines computing. Every 3 years or so we have a new technology that somehow we are not surprised by it. We expect to happen. What is the next thing? Cars that drive themselves. I don't know, space shuttles that take us to the moon. We expect it somehow. We've seen the movies from Hollywood. Somebody has been there. But there are areas that this is the greatest value of transformation, but we don't expect to improve based on this. For example, healthcare. We want robots, I don't know, something more technological oriented to improve our services, medical services. We are not actually there, but small improvements based on artificial intelligence, may based on telemedicine, may based on blockchain electronic records, all these things for the healthcare industry is something that they don't even know. The doctor doesn't know about this. So you need somewhere in the back to prepare all these things, even if this is the accounting department, even if this is healthcare records that have to be protected. So all these things, it's not the core business of the doctor, but it has to be supported by a transformation in the hospital and even in the mindset of the president of the hospital that wants to be modern, whatever that means. So there is a great degree of exploitation in a good manner that will give better services. We can treat patients with virtual reality. Can you imagine someone who has a casket and can give you some very good advice because he sees an X-ray, but it's not just an X-ray, he can see through something else. The use of medical devices on us. If you see this right now, this is a wearable that has my heart rate.
Yeah.
It counts how many steps I walk every day. And it has an oximeter, so I know if my oxygen level is at the right time. Back then, I had to go to make a checkup to understand what's going on. Now I have it on me. I don't know if it's good for me or not, because if I don't walk enough steps every day, I will be guilty. But somehow the technology is there. It's on us. We will not become cyborgs, but we can use the technology on our advantage for our health. Another area that we didn't see it coming is education. So you somehow increase the visibility of students and the educators using the technology. If I had back at my days the internet and not the encyclopedia, I could go in there and say, okay, it's an easy exercise, I have it on the Google. Back then, I had to go to the library to get the book and read the book. Somehow, it's the same process, but now it's transformed. It's digitally transformed. You understand this generation, based on my generation. I'm not talking about you because you are far younger than me, but if you see your father and your mother and you say, what were they doing back then? We were doing what was available, but now it's a different way of learning. And there is also equity. Everybody has the same opportunities. If I don't have enough money to buy an encyclopedia, I can have enough money to buy a tablet and actually have in front of me the Library of Alexandria, every book in the world. And I have it on my mobile phone of 50 euros or something like that. So you see that things are improving even on a social level. And this is transformation. To this generation, they believe that this was always there. My kids, when they see technology, when they see tablets, they see my laptop, they believe that this is actually magic. The school that they use technology, they believe that this is Hogwarts School of Magic from Harry Potter, because they see things and they are amazed. And this is the inspiration to learn, not get a book, study, and say, okay, I did it. But this is will drive whole generation. This is also transformation. There is also something called STEM, science, technology, engineering, mathematics. This is actually an integrated approach, not to see every subject by itself, but integrated through projects. The kids are doing projects at work, and they understand what we do at work today. They do it at school. They get certificates in the first elementary class about using Microsoft Office. I did this, I'm not sure even if I got a certificate for Office when I was 35. So you see, this is a bright future coming on, and we have to embrace it because this is going to be interesting. The last thing I wanted to give you an example on how we can change things that we do not expect is the public sector, is how governments are preparing services for us to be more close to our needs. And this is very difficult change. You know why? Because as you said, the mindset is very difficult to change in a whole country. You have to bring with you people, governments, and investment. Some countries like Estonia, which are 1 million citizens, they have managed it because, as I've read, they had a common direction. They knew where the destination is. They had differences how to get there, but the destination was clear. We have to be digital. And there is something I'm not sure you can we can discuss about this later on. If you have something in Africa or in America, we have in Europe something called DESI, D-E-S-I. This is the digital measurement of how each country is processing. It's called the Digital Economy and Society Index. And you have a number. You have a quantifiable number saying every year at what position among the 27 countries of Europe your country is in. The characteristics, what they measure, is connectivity, human capital, use of internet services, integration of digital services, and digital public services, and they count it. So see, even if you believe that you are in a good position, you benchmark your country against others. And unfortunately, Greece is at the lowest level, so we're giving a fight on this. The solution to the problem is that you have to acknowledge the problem. So if you know the problem, you can find a solution. If you just ignore it, there is no chance you will do something about it. So this is my approach. Any questions on this?
Still on the same. I wanted to hear from you. Like, has COVID actually accelerated the rate of transformation, or it is all about some specific temporary solutions that are going to last or even not going to last? What is your take?
Okay, I will give you an example about where I work in banking. At a point, somehow we understood that there might be a complete lockdown, and the banks had to still operate because people needed money, they needed to get loans, and most of the universe, the whole earth, was not prepared for full lockdown. We had e-banking, we have e-services, but most of the processes somehow required to be at the branch. Even if to open an account, traditional banks wanted to be there to give your ID. So somehow this requirement for faster and accelerated approach enforced something that would happen in the next 10 or 15 years, and it happened in 1 or 2 months.
Yeah.
So talk about acceleration. And all the things, even to give you any more example from what I said before, healthcare. My parents if they wanted to get the subscription for a drug, they had to go to the doctor. To go to the doctor, you have to get an appointment after 3 weeks. So you have to arrange somehow to be there. Now you just send an email, they reply with a code, and you go to pharmacy and you get it. It's so simple, yet it required something this bad, like the COVID-19, to make it work. So yes, it accelerates things in an unimaginable way.
Thank you so much, Nikos. This is a great discussion, and thank you so much for sharing with us today. To our viewers, thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate. So if you don't want to miss out on more sessions like these ones, just hit the subscribe button so that you don't miss out. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Nikos.
Thank you very much, Veronica.
Pleasure having you here.